Normally, we're here to answer your gaming and game night questions, but it's our last show of 2023 and our first show of 2024. So we're breaking from our usual format to do a pretty typical podcast end of year thing.
Yeah, aka it's a holiday and we're in the middle of the holidays and it's a lot less work to sit and talk about last year and what happened than to actually prep a full episode and, you know, come up with answers and game recommendations and stuff. So, yeah, we're being lazy.
Well, don't worry. We'll get back to answering game and game night questions next episode.
So the big thing I want to focus on tonight, because like everyone does a yearly recap at the end of the year, but I want to specifically talk about games, the games we played and stuff like that. And I want to save things like, you know, what was your most popular podcast episode or what was your favorite topic of the last year or what's your best performing blog post? Two player date night games again exploded. But anyway, that I think we're going to save for our 6 year anniversary episode, which happens in July. So we're going to save like the podcast stuff for that. For this, though, I just want to talk about games we played in 2023 and games released in 2023 and stuff like that. Starting with, you know, the basic stats.
Note, we are recording this on December 27th. So there's a chance we'll get in some additional games before the end of the year, especially with New Year's Eve coming up.
Yep. So my total games played in 2023 was 385 plays of 118 unique games, though only 22, which were new to me, which that seemed wrong. Like that was BG Stats. And I didn't have the time today to using the BG Stats app to like go through. Cause like we didn't just review 22 games this year. Like that doesn't seem possible that only 22 were new to me out of 118 unique games, but whatever. I don't know how BG Stats came up with that unique games. New to me games, but that's what it claims is only 22 new to me games. Now, last year, just to do a quick comparison, this was way better, which makes sense. More games played, different games played, new to me games, and a heck of a lot less sheltering at home and wearing masks and more public play events and going out to cons and so on. Now, 2024, I am pretty sure, is going to be higher, right? Because there's some new local game nights being planned by some other people. We're planning to attend at least two cons in 2024. Plus, I'm hoping to get some more regular game nights started up at my house.
Well, I got in 175 plays of 68 games, 51 of which were new to me, apparently.
Wow. That's huge.
The board game arena plays have really quite petered out over time since the end of lockdowns, which has actually pushed my numbers down a lot from the previous years, but they are now representing more real plays, if you want to look at it that way.
Yeah, more physical plays with real people in person. I don't even know if I played on Board Game Arena this year. This year feels like three times longer than it actually was. Though not as long as the 20 years before COVID started, but at least just like, you know, like 2019 to 2022 was 17 years or so. And last year was three, something like that. I don't know. So as I mentioned, like I do a BG Stats now. I finally bit the bullet and bought that silly app. And though I've been fighting with it for a few things, I finally seem to have it set up so it actually auto syncs back and forth. Because for a long time, it went one way, but not the other. Like if I put my plays on BoardGameGeek, they showed up here, but not the other way. That's all fixed now. So that's cool. One of the things it did tell me about was H factor. I don't know what H stands for at all. Possibly it's the person who came up with this thing. I don't know what H factor is, but you'd look at the number of games you played and then the number of times you played each game. So like if I played, this game 9 times, and then I look at how many games I played 9 times, and you find the spot where those are equal. So if like 9 equals 9, so like the number of games you played is Y and the number of times you played the game is X, you figure out the spot where X equals Y. So I this seemed pretty sad. I don't know how this, what I usually get, but I got a 9. So that meant I have at least 9 games I played at least 9 times. There's at least 9 games I played 9 times, or there's 9 games that I played at least 9 times. It's somewhere one of those, which I gotta call out one of the fans of the show, Sarah, who created the 10x10 challenge, and say, sorry, I guess I failed this year. Not that I officially signed up to do one, but I did not play 10 different games 10 times this year, which seems a little low, disappointing. I feel like I should have hit that without trying, especially with the number of party games we played this year.
So the H index, which gives us the H value, is actually something from journals and publications, educational publications. Okay. So it's defined as the maximum value of H such that a given author journal has published at least H papers that have each been cited at least H times. So it's games and plays in this case versus papers and citations.
Okay.
I did not do well. My H value was 6. Despite being in Windsor now, I'm still mostly playing completely different games every time we get together, yeah, with public events helping to push my play counts up a little bit, but not that much.
Yeah, I think the 51 new to you out of 68 games is a good indication of that one. And I'm actually slightly surprised it wasn't 5 exactly, because of our whole we try to play games 5 times. I'm surprised it wasn't 5 games 5 times just to fit that. All right. So for those who care about those stats, there you go. We both failed the 10 by 10. We both would have succeeded in a 5 by 5 challenge, but only if we didn't have to pick the games ahead of time. So I got to say, overall, and the more physical plays together, together and apart at physical tables is always great to see. And I still expect that's going to go even higher next year. I hope. Next though, let's look at our most played games. So this one, it's, I always find this fascinating. Like the games I played the most isn't always what I expect them to be. And it's what I like to hear from other podcasters. So what I'm going to do is we're going to start with our top 10, going to our 10th least played games, whatever. Number one is going to be our most played game. So we're going from 10 to 1. So this was a huge surprise to me, and that is my number 10 out of a ton is Trick Draw. That was the rapid fire card game that I'd like. I don't know what I expected from it, but like I thought it was going to be a deck builder or it was going to be Uno, but it's a tableau. It was funky. It's a rapid fire tableau building game. And but yeah, we played a bunch of times to review it. But then I brought it out to the barbershop bar a couple times and I guess it added up. Really solid card game. I didn't think it'd be one of my most played games of the year.
And actually, my number 10 is also Trick Draw. yeah. Again, we did play it a bunch of times out in public. So I guess it shouldn't be surprising. I mean, it's just a solid game that plays really quickly, and it is so easy to teach anyone to pick up. It's just, you know, really easy to get it to the table a number of times.
Yeah, I agree. So I fully will admit that was a game we got to the table a bunch of times and I haven't really touched much since. Though really, to be fair, since September, I can't get to it. So it's not even in our backdrop back there. So that could be a big factor in why we haven't played it more. Now, at the complete opposite end of the spectrum, I have Catch the Moon, which I'm like, holy cow, that's in my top, that's number 9. I unboxed this game last week, and it's one of my most played games of the year already. Well, that kind of makes sense once you know the game. We are doing a full review of this one later. It's a fun, quick dexterity game, and I don't think I've ever sat down to play it with someone and we only played once. It's always usually about 3 times in a row before people get sick of it. Sometimes it's 5 to 10.
So for me, the Deadleaf, because we had a few local plays as well as plays at Origins, which snuck this game in with yet another easy to teach trick taker that really anyone can pick up and is just great for a wide range of players.
Next up for me, we're at number 8, is Bah Humbug in the 12 Days of Christmas. Now, I knew this was going to be high because I wanted to try a bunch of the different games in there before our review. Again, later this episode, that was coincidental that those two follow each other. But the thing is, instead of just trying a bunch of different games, I keep going back and playing the same games because they're so good. I've been enjoying introducing them to different players. Like, oh, here, check out this cool game. You can play with these cards. This happened at the barbershop bar. The thing is, I wish I could log plays of each individual game because to me, they feel like completely different standalone games, but you can't. But I will tell you straight up, The Giving Season, the trick-taking tableau builder that Sean played this one with D&I at Cafe Amore. That is the number 1 game out of Humbug in the 12 Games of Christmas for me.
Not surprising. So for me, Heat, pedal to the metal. Now, this one is on Board Game Arena, and it did go members only after a while, and I have actually canceled my membership. But while this game was free, I played the heck out of it when it was first released on Board Game Arena. And while I think for a regular group game, if I were going to buy a game to play with people, I would probably still prefer Rallyman GT. He does a lot of things really well, and the solo game for it is fantastic. So,
yeah, that's one that's still on my wish list. Yeah,
it's got a lot of buzz this year, and I think rightfully so.
Yeah, that, this is on a ridiculous number best of 2023 lists. They keep more keep popping up day by day. We kind of have our own going on right now, and here it is even on our list, but as a most played. My next one is Boop. I'm not surprised. I guess I'm surprised it's not quite as high. I thought it might be a little higher. This is the abstract strategy game about cats jumping on a bed. Played a ton of it. My kids dig it. I like it. And the big one is the theme makes this a very easy sell for public play events. Now, the thing is, though, when I bring it out to public play events, I don't play. I just teach. And I don't log my teaches as plays unless I actually play the game as well. I have taught a lot of games of Boop that I haven't played in because it's so easy to pick up at a public play event because people just dig the cats, the board. And even if I'm playing Boop, someone will come up and be like, oh, what is this? And I'll be like, here, do you want to take over? So, or we're almost done. Do you want to play the next round? So Boop is my number seven.
Fair enough. So for me, it's Dice Kingdoms of Valeria, the roll and write Valeria game. Now, this one did wear out its welcome for some people, but with the variety of adding in the expansion pack, we got a lot of plays of this in, and I'm really not sorry we did. I don't know how often it's going to come out again, but while we were playing it and while we were sort of in that that small box Valeria mode, it was a solid game.
Yeah, we definitely did more than five on that one. That was one we played quite a bit. And to be fair, it was packed to bring to Brenda's the other day because my kids also enjoy that one. She enjoys it. So we didn't play it. We were playing Tycho instead. But like, I'm still bringing that game out. I enjoyed it. It just missed the list. Number six is one that was on Sean's list already. For me, that is the Deadlies. And while the only reason it's higher on my list is I bring it out to more public play events, Sean's not at. This one's no surprise at all, though I honestly think it probably could have been higher. I think I might have forgotten to log some plays, and it probably belongs a bit higher up. This is like I brought this to my uncles, who's not a gamer, and I played with like my aunts, and we brought this out on Christmas Eve, and my mom played. And anyone who knows my mom knows like traditional card games, yes. Anything but that, no, I'm not a gamer. And here we have my mom playing Deadlies. I honestly, the Deadlies is fantastic. It's to be fair, it's the new Garinto, right? Remember how like last year, 2 years ago, I don't even know when we were talking about Garinto. Garinto was the game where like no one's heard of this game, but you have to buy it. If you see Garinto, buy it. Now it's the Deadlies. Like no one's heard of the Deadlies. Everyone should have heard about the Deadlies and should go pick up a copy. I'm going to keep talking about this game until more people start talking about this game and going, yeah, I have it. I played it. I know people who have played it with me and ordered it on their phone while sitting playing with me.
All right. Well, there we go. Mine is next is Disney Sorcerer's Arena. Now, we got a lot of play out of this. And thankfully, I don't count my mobile app version plays because I play that pretty much every day, at least once since you got the game. And I wanted to figure out what the difference was between the online and the physical version. And I just kind of got hooked with it. But the physical board game is just a solid tactical squad game with good difficulty, but an easy to approach aesthetic that's really easy to get involved with.
I will be mentioning that game in a little bit. Next one for me is another just makes sense logically. Number five. Is six three colored rings that are around a castle and monsters are charging towards you. This makes sense. This is Castle Panic Big Box. There's the main game and four different expansions in here, and we wanted to play through them all one at a time and try them combined with each other, as well as introduce the kids to various versions and bring it out to public play events. And honestly, there's no surprises on this list. But the big surprise to me is how much I ended up enjoying the game with the expansions. Specifically, once we added Crowns and Quests, that final expansion that just changed the entire vibe of the game. The goal of the game changes, and Castle Panic went from me for a meh to one of the best games I played this year.
Fair enough. So next up for me, the number five is Haggis. This has been a long-standing three-player game that has been going on Board Game Arena since I first started playing Board Game Arena, playing with both Game Time and Satsuwata. And interestingly, they updated the game this year. It has actually changed to a newer, more modern rule set on Board Game Arena, which has introduced some slight changes with bidding for the opening roll. But despite those changes, it is still a great, straightforward card game that just keeps coming back over and over again.
Next up is the reason Boop is lower. Shobu. I knew this was going to be on this list. Deanna and I played a lot of Shobu. I played a lot of Shobu at public play events. I've introduced people to Shobu. I knew it would be higher than Boop because, as we talked about in our review, while I'm glad I own both Boop and Shobu, and I find them to be quite different, though similar, for playing at home, playing with my wife and playing with my kids, Shobu wins out for me as the more enjoyable game. And we keep returning to that time and time again. If we're headed out to the county to hit a coffee shop and maybe a brewery later, I'm going to pack Shobu over Boop. Though if I'm going to the barbershop bar, I'm still going to grab Boop because it has that universal appeal.
Alrighty. Well, next up for me is Psychobabble. Now, public plays really helped push this one up in my rankings. Again, it's just so simple to teach and quick to play. I'm really sensing a theme about my big game plays here.
Well, I got to say, in any of the you can play the whole game in 10 minutes versus the, you know, Marrakesh is not going to be on my most played games list. Probably not even next year, even if I try to play it as much as possible, just because of the length it takes to play the game. Next for me, we're at number three is Star Realms Frontiers. I said it during our review last week. We fell back in love with Star Realms and have been loving it since discovering Frontiers. Helps that both my kids ended up loving it as well. They continue to ask to play it. Gwen's now brought it to Walkerville with her to play with her friends. I've always loved Star Realms, but now we're back into it with Frontiers.
Well, next up for me is, once again, back to Board Game Arena, Sushi Go Party. When this was added into Board Game Arena, our play group there quickly jumped on it as a new challenge. And the variety of cards in the party version really make the game so much more replayable than the original.
Next at number two is where Disney Sorcerer's Arena Epic Alliances falls for me. Yes, we were playing it a lot and my kids dig it. So I played a lot with the kids. Plus, there were the early learning games when we went through the onboarding, which is four games right there that Deanna and I went through just to kind of learn the game. And then when my youngest daughter played, I went through the onboarding again. This one's up there well past the double digits. Well, not past the double. It's still double digits, but it's high up in the double digits. Just because of the number of times I've taught the game and played it. And the thing is, though, it's not just because I was trying to learn it. Now, what did bump this even higher is the fact we reviewed all four of the expansions. So there was a lot of required plays in there, but you know what? I never minded. It's a very solid skirmish game. Though I am now a little worried that it may be going away. There were an awful lot of sales on Sorcerer's Arena over the holidays. And I got to say, that'd be a shame because it's such a solid game. This is a game I would love to dedicate more time to, like deep dive, like a collectible card game, right? Like try to figure out the meta and try to figure out card combos and what characters work best. And if I'm facing off against someone using this character, who should I use, right? I think that game could go deep and hard that way. The problem is there's no local organized play for it. And I don't think that's just here in Windsor. I don't think there's a lot of organized play going on at all, which may be why I'm starting to see it on sale everywhere.
Fair, but unfortunate. Now, next for me, again, with Board Game Arena is Go Nuts for Donuts. Now, I was really surprised that this one is actually as high as it is. I know I play my Board Game Arena games a lot, but the flow of this game is so great. And I guess it's just easier than I thought to start into a new game without even really noticing you're not still playing the last one. Unfortunately, that may be because I'm not great at the game. And if I collected more donuts, I'd notice that I suddenly had no donuts one day. It's one of these games where, you know, all of our group tend to win once in a while. And you're either great or horrible at it. I don't have an in-between on this game at all. I'm either at the bottom or at the top.
That's one I still haven't even tried. Maybe that should be one of my resolutions for next year, is to get more back into Board Game Arena. Or maybe not. I don't know. I don't know if that's a good or a bad thing. It would definitely up my unique gameplay. So this leads me to my most played game of 2023. And this is no shock to me for the reason Sean already mentioned, and that is Psychobabble. I just played it again 5 times on Saturday. Now, one of the problems with that game is, like, what's a full game, right? You always have that problem with these party games is what do you log? If I play 5 rounds with 5 different people playing the psychoanalyst, is that 5 plays or is that 1 play going runs around the table? But it doesn't matter. This is by far the best social deduction game I played. It's been a huge hit at home with the family, but even more so out at our public play events. Like, at this point, this is the game you just always pack, right? Like people who, like, go to cons and always keep a copy of Werewolf with them. Well, if I'm going to a public play event, I'm going to bring a copy of Psychobabble.
Fair enough. Well, for me, my number one is still Sushi Go, the original. Now, which this isn't a big shock because it is very quick to play, even more so than the party version, as there is less to think about with that more basic set of cards in play. So this one just cycles through, even though we still play. We have switched primarily to the Sushi Go party. There's always this game of Sushi Go going in the background, and it just churns faster.
I just find it ironic that you're still playing both with the same group of people. You think you'd stop one for the other. All right, just so people know, I am just going to drop my next 15, but I don't want to talk about them. I'll be here all night. So I'm just to give you the list, to give an idea of the other games that I played a bunch of this year. We've got Birds of a Feather, Kapow, Reality Shift, Court, that one surprised me, Downforced, Point Salad, Tome, Astra, Aurum, Crystallized, Distilled, The Game, Illiterati, Viticulture, and Seas of Havoc.
Now, I have so many games at 2 to 3 plays each. It's kind of a long list, and you can pick them in any order at this point. But I think we all know that they're going to be pretty similar to Mo's list. So we'll skip listing that out directly.
So one of the things that I thought seemed pretty obvious based on our list here is that, hey, look, we're board game reviewers. Compared to previous years, almost everything in that list are not only review copies, but like review copies we just got. I'm actually sad to not see games I love making the list. Like for years, if I did this list, you're going to get stuff like Azul or Power Grid on there. And like, yes, Viticulture is on the list. You know why Viticulture is on the list? Because I needed to relearn it to review Viticulture World. Not because I love Viticulture, though I do love Viticulture. Like really the only old game on that entire list going down to my top, like whatever, I think, what did we do with 10, 25? I did my top 25 games. The only thing on there that's really an old game that I play all the time is The Game. So that was a little surprising to see in my face. I was like, wow, okay. I like, yes, we're a podcast. We review games, but like we always talk about, we're not the new hotness. And I'm like, oh yeah, they're new to us. They may not be published, but we're still, seems like we're doing a lot more review games than not. So now there's reasons for this. For one, not a lot of open game nights. So when we did get together, we had to play the Pile of Obligation. Like these, we are obliged to review these games. So we do need to play them in order to be able to review them. So that's fair. And again, we do the thing where we try to play games about 5 times each so that we actually deep dive it and make sure we're playing by the proper rules. And we're not doing the rapid fire, play it once, put out an opinion, play the next one. For good or bad, I guess, in the case of number of games. The other one is our Friday night group was Tori, Kat, Deanna, and I. Well, Tori and Kat produced a baby. The Clark messed that one up. So they're new parents and dealing with all the things new parents do. And we haven't gamed with them since they had Clark. So that is a big chunk out of our monthly, weekly gaming. And I never did get that Monday night group back together, public play before COVID, I was running one every other weekend, if not every weekend, depending. So less public play. So all of that means less games played, less time to play games, like less overall games played in the year, which forced us to focus on those review copies. And you've heard Sean mention on the show, like, yeah, I'd love to play stuff more than once, but we don't have time. So I think my first goal for 2024, here's my first resolution, I guess, is more game nights where we just play games we like and already know. Like, once we get the basement back, I really want to try to have a game night regular here, X day of the week, rain or shine, we're playing something here at my house. I don't know what day of the week it'll be, if it'll be our Monday night or a Friday night, or maybe it'll be I don't think it'll be a Wednesday night, because I can't see that fitting in while we're podcasting. But some night of the week, I would like to get things to back to having a regular game night here.
Yeah, and so the year has been tumultuous in many ways, between health issues and construction projects, unexpected construction projects. So while you game a lot with your family, outside of that, it's just been a lot more limited. And that's the great reason why our numbers are really so varied, is that, while I game with you guys all the time, you're gaming even more with both the kids, who are now, of an age when and of a demeanor that they really enjoy playing a lot of these games, but also your Sunday games whenever possible. I know you had a delay even there. Like, your numbers would be even higher had there not been flooding at both of your homes.
Yes. Yep. So we're only just started that back up. So
there's been a significant number of limits between health and building issues. We hope will be dealt with, and we can move on to a fresh start in 2024.
Now, the other thing that kind of slapped me in the face was all board games, no RPGs. Like I would have sworn I ran something. I remember running Runaway Hirelings online for some of our patrons, which was pretty cool. But like, I guess that wasn't last year. I guess that was in 2021. So it's now been 2 years since I played or run an RPG, which is just sad. And like, usually, like, we go to Origins, I usually play games. This year with Origins, and we had a lot of fight to get our badges, and we weren't sure we were going until the last minute. Because of that, I didn't book anything ahead of time, and usually I book some games, and I did not book any games, because by the time we were going to Origins, and we knew when you went into Eventbrite or whatever it was, their app, any DM I wanted to play under, their tables were full. So I didn't even get to play. Like, normally it's like, oh, if I go to a con, I at least play under some friends or under some, I'll try to play games with the designer, stuff like that. And no, none of that happened. So I did read a couple things. The One Ring core rule book. Technically I'm in like a monster section that's kind of bored. Kind of boring and hard to get through. I did read and review the Warhammer fourth edition starter set, but I didn't run it. We didn't play it.
So while I've gotten plays of Masks, Supers, Revised Edition games, actually ongoing, I even had one Savage Worlds game online. For me, I really need to start reading and working on the list of games that I started and then never touched again. And possibly even get some reviews done for the channel, either text reviews for the blog or, another possible Seven Supers episodes that doesn't include my M&M and P&P. So
no, I'd still, you got to pick one of the, like, Champions for sure. Never review Champions. We'll never talk about it. And I'm tempted to say, like, M&M, just never actually mention M&M ever again.
As this is better than, or this is worse than, but never actually review M&M.
Yes. Like, never. I don't even know if you're better than or worse than. Just like, skip it every time, because we get so much interaction from people. What about Champions? What about M&M? Those are the two.
Yeah. And I'm like, we just have to avoid it. Baragons, I really should review, because it really is a solid game.
No, that's totally fair.
But I know people do comment on that, about that one as well. So,
yep. My second goal, I don't know if I want to call it a resolution, I kind of hate that term, is to, for 2024, is run some RPGs in some way, fashion. Now, I'm not foolish enough to expect a full group or a weekly game night, but you know what? At least a short campaign, some single sessions, something, anything.
Yeah, I would love to get a masks game together, even just like a one shot at one of the barbershop events. But as someone who's actually never really GM'd a real game in person before, I did one game of Late Show for you guys back in like the high school days. Yep. But I got to work myself up for that. But if I can put together a game, I may end up running a masks game locally.
There you go. I will admit, I'm going to blame our Discord members just a little bit here. I did offer to run Redbox D&D, and there were some people who jumped up and not enough play. So that might have actually been last year, too, because as we quarantine.
So we figured out that you ran Hirelings in the summer of 2020. So
there you go.
3.5 years. Well,
it's still ago, over two years. That's yeah. Still not quite 3 years at this point. Still pretty bad. All right. We played lots of games. We talked about what we played a lot, but you know what? What we played the most is often not the best games we played. Like Sean said, Sushi Go's great, but I don't think he's got it as his top game of all time and has fully admitted that Sushi Go Party is better than Sushi Go. So I think what we're going to do is a bunch of top threes here, just so, again, we're not here all night talking games. We may talk about each of these games. We may just fly through them. So I'm going to start with my top three new-to-me games that I played for the first time in 2023. One, I still haven't played by the proper rules, but I'm putting Marrakesh on this list. It just felt so good to return to a heavy Feld. I love Stefan Feld games. I love Point Salad. It was so enjoyable to play that style of game again. Marrakesh, by the time we review it, it may be the best game I review next year at this point. Next would be Distilled, or feeling like Marrakesh in an hour, in a way. Because it hit all those nice medium to heavyweight Euro feel, but in literally an hour playtime with people who know how to play it, with three of us, we almost finished in an hour with a teach. So this still just rubs all those nice, happy Euro, medium Euro itches and just enough meatiness with some randomness. I really dig it. And then my third is going to be Artemis Project from Graham Gamers Guild. Really digging this worker dice placement game, dice placement, worker placement game, building things. And again, for that very elegant, quick six rounds, doesn't take 3 hours, but feels like you played a nice epic game.
All right. So up for me, the first up is DC Deck Building Injustice. Now, this is a slight variance for the DC Deck Building. It's sort of a new system, but to me, it is the best PvP game they've come out with yet. So I mean, good. If you can get your hands on it, and if you are into the competitive style of DC deck building, Injustice I think is really a kind of a must have.
Nice.
Next up would be Heat Pedal to the Metal. Now again, I haven't played this physically, but the game is just so well organized and so just, it just feels good. You know, you can the card play and the way that you're accelerating and maintaining speed is just a fantastic racing game. And while I realize racing games aren't for everyone, I found out that I'm actually a fan of racing board games.
There you go.
GT. Yeah, no, absolutely. And then to wrap it up, Disney Sorcerer's Arena. I'm not a huge fan of skirmish games, but this one is doing it right for me. Whether it's because of the theming, you can't say it's an easier game. It's really not less complex than a lot of the other skirmish games out there. But it just feels a little more comfortable, maybe because you're familiar with the content and the characters. Yeah.
Now, as usual, most of the games that were new to us this year weren't actually released in 2023. We often say we're not the new hotness, but we actually did play a fairly large number of games that are listed as released in 2023. Now, note, I am going with Board Game Geek release dates, so please don't jump on me if these don't actually fit and the game came out in Europe years before or whatever. It was kickstarted and I don't know. I'm going with the Board Game Geek numbers here, okay, because that's what I have. My tops for 2023 are going to be Aurum from Pandasaurus, the deck building game where you can't follow suit is probably the most noticeable part of it. Distilled, which I already just talked about why I like that. And then the mashup of naval war game, worker placement, and deck building that is Seas of Havoc.
Well, and I'm, you know what? Again, mine are actually going to be very similar here. So Aurum, absolutely. It's just fantastic. Seas of Havoc. While the game isn't necessarily going to be on my top list, what they did with it, the different combination of mechanics they put together here really makes for an interesting game, even if there are, it does have some aspects that don't necessarily work perfectly for me. And then DC Deck Building Injustice, which was he's on two of my lists now because I did actually play the hot new hotness there. I got that straight off the Kickstarter. And again, it's just fantastic. So here we go.
All right. So it's obvious I need to play more RPGs, maybe something with Thaco so I can practice my basic math. So sorry, it has been 3 years and 4 months since I've run a role playing game. Thank you, Math Guy Dave, who's obviously aptly named. Next, I want to go into most unique games. Unique is very subjective, but like just stuff we hadn't really seen before. I'm going to go with three again, just sticking with three just because it's, I don't know, whatever. Three is a magic number. Number one's going to be Block and Key. This is another one that we just got to here at the end of the year. And I couldn't help but compare it to Mountains Out of Molehills because they look so similar, but the games have absolutely nothing in common. This is a spatial ceramic block placing game that just it has that feature of which way you are looking matters. So like you need to see things from your side of the board. I really enjoyed it. I love the chunky pieces. We'll be talking more about this one in the Bellhop's Tabletop. Next would be Reality Shift Deluxe, the 3D racing game. You have light cycle type things racing sci-fi on cubes that can be moved. They're magnetic. Like the whole concept is just so awesome. And then last is one of the murder mystery escape room games we played, and that is Body of Evidence, because it added a paper corpse and an entire autopsy part of the game, which I was just like, I never thought I'd be playing a board game where I'm cutting into a corpse that its nose doesn't buzz when I mix up. So I just the entire concept of that series of games with the coroner aspect combined with the clue solving and puzzles, I just thought it was pretty groundbreaking.
All right. Well, I decided to, even though I could easily pick some of those of the same, I decided to go with three others. And for me, that's Kapow, because while no, it's not the first ever dice building game, I think they did some really interesting things compared with the theming. And so as a superhero battler, Kapow, combining that dice building concept with the multiple characters that you can swap in and out on top of your base abilities, made for a really interesting supers battling game. Yep. Next up, Seas of Havoc. Again, we've already said this several times, but the combination of mechanics, even though no single one of them is unique, they are combined in a brilliantly unique way. And then Fighting Fantasy Adventures, which isn't out yet, but still in the future. But a really interesting take on a Which Way book brought out into a group party deck, not deck building, a tableau building, a sort of adventure.
It was just a card-driven dungeon crawler.
Dungeon crawl, there we go.
Yeah, because you had a hand of cards, I guess, with your items. There was a little bit of card management with your powers. I would just say card-driven dungeon crawler.
But really looking forward to that. And I know a lot of people who have great memories of the original books back in the day are also looking forward to, having that back in their lives.
Yeah, and since, since you're just calling that out, that was technically a preview, right? A prototype preview we played. We have played quite a few of those. So I figure why not? Like, let's do a category of that. So you've already said Fighting Fantasy Adventures. That's the one you think is going to be good, the one you're looking forward to. For me, that's Bah Humbug. We'll be reviewing it tonight. Bah Humbug just blew me away with how enjoyable. I thought I was getting one game and a bunch of silly mini games, and those silly mini games are good enough to be solid games. And then Castellans of Valeria. I can't wait to see the production copy of that. It looks like it's going to be fantastic. Great area majority game with a ridiculous components and dual layer boards. Plus, it's Valeria. We love Valeria. And shockingly, I am looking forward to a party game that we didn't actually preview, but I got to sat down and play a demo copy at Origins, and that was What the Cup, which is Liar's Dice for Gamers. And again, we're not big party gamers, but there are a few party games I love, and one of those is Liar's Dice, or the European version, Meyer. And this is Liar's Dice with a D12 and a specially designed little cup for shaking it. That is going to be such a big hit at our local public play events. I can't wait for it.
Now, I'm not as big a fan of the previews, and I know we've had a few bummers and a few annoyances with some previews, with, you know, rule books not being ready and such. And we have sort of peeled back a little bit on doing previews for that reason. We are not play testers. We are reviewers. We can play test, but that's a different thing. So really for me, it's that fighting fantasy adventures that I think is really going to be a big hit with many groups when it finally releases.
Yeah, you'll notice this will be true in the coming year as well. Most of the stuff we're going to do previews of are from companies we've already worked with in the past, and we are generally previewing complete games anymore. The game has to be 99.9% finished before we're going to agree to preview. So we could have went the other way, and so we're going to preview more next tonight. Year.
Except for the preview we're doing tonight.
as I said, next year. Next year we're going to try to. But again, we got to play it. We got to try it. So there was more of a reason for that one. What we got left? You know what? I think next we'll talk about this. Probably my last one here before we start looking to the future. So I'm just going to give the folks in the chat a chance here. Is there anything about 2023 you want to quiz us on? Is there a game type you want to know? And any questions about our the last year gaming related? Again, not podcast favorite episodes or anything like that, but if there's anything you want to know, now's your time to ask. And while we're giving a little bit of time to stew over that, we're going to get into our biggest surprises. Again, I'm going to go with three. Did I do three? I think, yeah, I did do three here. So my first one is the Deadlies and honestly, Psycho Babylon. I'm going to group those two for one specific reason. We didn't ask for these. In a way, Psychobabble specifically, I said no. Yet the publisher or representative of the publisher talked us into taking these games home from Origins and basically insisted that we take them home, and both have proven to be huge hits, extremely popular games. And it's not just like, oh, wow, they're great at public play events, yet I hate playing them and I hate bringing them out, but they're popular. No, I even enjoy these games. So those are two of my biggest surprises, because like I wasn't even going to touch these games. And the third, which I actually thought was from last year, but doing some digging, it was early in the year this year, we discovered My Little Pony Adventures in Equestria, the deck building game from Renegade Games. I never would have thought that a My Little Pony deck building game would not necessarily would be good, but would be a detailed, interesting, resource-filled strategic card game that it is.
Yeah, MLP was definitely a shocker for me. I had to pull my foot out of my mouth after making all sorts of My Little Pony jokes about this game, only to discover that this thing had a lot going on, was even doing some unique mm-hmm. costing and things within it. Another one that I didn't have on my list, but I think is worth mentioning as a shocker, is Trick Draw. We both had this on our top 10, and it's not the game we were expecting. We were expecting a trick-taking game,
yes,
and that's not what it is, and yet it was still good enough to make both of our top 10s. So props to the folks at House Fish Balloon for coming up with that. And then the next one is, it seems like it should have been longer ago, but it was only in January last year that we finally got our first play of Weather Machine. And it was extreme, and we've only played it that once, but it really kind of flipped something about the kind of games I like, showing me that heavy games are more interesting than I sometimes might have thought.
Fair enough. All right, the chat's letting us down, but that's fine. It's the holidays, they're relaxing. We didn't get anything else. So we're going to move on to some 2024 thoughts. And we are going to start off with what I think is a pretty big announcement, at least for us. This is a milestone for our podcast. And it's one of the most awesome things coming for 2024 is that we are now officially sponsored for 2024 by Grand Gamers Guild. So a huge thank you goes out to Mark Spector, sorry, and I'm going to mess up his name now that he's sponsoring us. Mark Spector from Triple G for reaching out to us and offering to sponsor the show in the new year. Now, you all know how much we love Mark's games, but that was well established before this relationship. Mark and I got to know each other through Gorinto. He sent me a prototype of Gorinto because he liked one of my reviews, and I couldn't even tell you what. We sat and played it at a local coffee shop, the N and I, and I instantly fell in love. And he was the first publisher that I had a chat open with. And we just kept going back and forth, like, hey, this, and I think this would be cool. And I like, because this was, yes, I was doing free play testing, but you know what? At the time, I liked the game so much. I had some suggestions for improvements and questions. And well, to be fair, Mark, after that point, I became a fan of him and he became a fan of ours. He is one of the Tabletop Bellhop's biggest fans and advocates, always trying to get more people to listen to our show. I don't know how many times I'm on social media and I notice, you got to mention, someone said Tabletop Bellhop, I look and it's Mark saying, hey, check out these two folks that do a great show. So that's awesome. So, you know what? I think we've had a great experience with Mark. And I really like, I'm already gushing about himself before this happens. So I don't think this is something that's going to impact our show negatively in any way. It's only a good thing.
Now, of course, this doesn't mean we will be all Grand Gamers Guild all the time, nor no. will we be making sure that there's a guild game on every game's recommendation list. What this does mean is that we will be calling them out as a sponsor at the top of each of our 2024 episodes, and we'll be including a short ad segment in after the Ask the Bellhop segment before the coffee break. This will probably highlight their latest Kickstarters, newly released games, and things like that.
Now, the other bonus is this sponsorship actually includes something for you, our listeners, as well. Mark has provided us with an exclusive discount code that you can use anytime you're on the Grand Gamers Guild shop to pick up anything or any of their games. You get 10% off with this. So any order you make, Grand Gamers Guild, be sure to enter Bellhop, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, to get 10% off. And as far as I can tell, this is going to stack with all existing offers. For example, I was able to put the holiday hijinks bundle they put out with the Kringle Caper, Thanksgiving, and there was a third one, the pumpkin one, all in one package. I put it in and it's discounted for a package discount, and our bellhop stacked with that. So I thought that was pretty cool. So that's kind of our gift from us, from Sean and I, as well as from Mark Spector of Grand Gamers Guild for all the bellhop fans. You can now get Gorinto cheaper because Gorinto is amazing, and you should go get Gorinto from Grand Gamers Guild.
And don't forget, even though they are sponsoring us, we do have other companies that deal with us as well. Be willing to check in Bellhop, B-L-L-H-O-P, wherever you're trying games to see if it works. We do have lists on the website where we'll tell you it'll work or not, but go ahead, throw our code in there everywhere just in case.
It may just work. And say if it doesn't, try Bellhop 10, because Outsmarted, for some reason, made us change our code. Mm. Now, as for other plans in 2024, we're going to be sticking with the same schedule we have now. This is just for everyone's information's sake. We're going to be recording Wednesday nights, 8 p.m. Eastern. That's not going to change. Episodes are going to go live on the following Tuesday. Other content on the blog and YouTube will be scattered between those episodes. Maybe at some point in the year when things are a little less disruptive, that'll be on a more regular schedule. But right now, we're going to get it out when we can get it out.
We will have planned breaks for the Gamma Expo and Origins, as well as next November when the holidays start up again, with unfortunately occasional breaks throughout the year for family vacations and the inevitable cancellations due to illness appointments, etc. That's just how things work when you don't record content in advance. But we'd rather have the interactions with you, our audience, live here rather than just storing up episodes in the background.
Yes. Now, as for gaming, I will be continuing to co-host game nights at the Barbershop Bar once a month, but currently don't have any other solid plans for public play events. Now, I do know another local Windsor game group is starting up something new at the Walkerville Brewery in January. So that could become a regular event, so I'll be watching that. Now, as mentioned earlier, I do hope to do is get a regular game night at home here in our house going once again. But my basement has to get finished before that'll start. So we plan on keeping our regular Sunday night dinner and gaming events at Brenda's going as well.
There will, of course, be other random weekday and weeknight game nights, mini Sean Cons, and what have you throughout the year.
Now, those gameplays will, of course, focus on the various review copies we have with more coming, but I do want to toss in more plays of games we enjoy the most. Let's get past five plays on some of these games, not just playing everything five times, then moving on to the next one. So I'm hoping, you know, if we do a weekly game night setup, maybe we can specifically set that up as a no obligation game night, or at least limit it to, you know, one obligation game. But then from then on, we play something else.
And while I hold out hope, I'm not holding my breath for that.
Fair enough. Now, the other thing I would love to do is there is a non-obligation pile of shame that it keeps getting higher with Christmas. It just grew again. So what I want to do, it's probably a pipe dream, but I would love to reduce the pile. I think I say this every year in our end of year episodes, but I kind of want to put on like find a long weekend and literally do a reduce the pile of shame event. Don't worry about five plays. We don't play anything five times. There's no obligation. Play everything once and then make a decision. Was that cool enough to play again, or let's get rid of it? Because yeah. The other thing I want to do this year is reduce the size of my game collection. I want to get things to a much more manageable level, with the first goal being all the games fit on shelves. So you don't see stuff like the piles behind me and to my side. Actually, I'm zoomed in enough. You can't really see them. No piles of games. We want no piles. Like the pile of shame, I want it to be a shelf of shame instead of a pile of shame. So I have started on this one, listed a big group of games in the local gaming community. So if you are local, watch for that. Also on our Discord, I've been listing what's for sale.
Oh, sadly, shipping has only become more and more unreasonable in the past year. So it's local only at this point.
All right. Anything else you can think of that we should work towards in 2024 without overpromising?
Well, I know you're still not eager to change the video visual format and layouts, but we may still talk about that and whether or not that's going to happen or not. Now that you've got the Stream Deck, we may be able to make use of that into some of the broadcast and try and get things a little more dynamic during the show, maybe.
Yeah, so we're not just static heads talking to you all week, all day, all every week, all show every all week. All week
you will be here.
Yes, all week. That's our plan, is just be live 24/7 and constantly talking game. Then you get to see how little we actually play. We're going to get GoPros and we're just going to wear them from certain hours a day, and you get to see everything we do. No, none of that's going to happen. No, I still think what I need to do is like just give you an entire show. Like, here, do what you want with it. Let's see. Or even a month. Like we'll give Sean, like, April is Sean's month, and Sean, like, picks the topics and writes the format, and we'll see how that goes. It'd be like what do you call the yes, no testing? That's not the A-B testing. We'll do some A-B testing.
All right. Well, all right. There you have it. A look back at our year in gaming for 2023, as well as some thoughts and info on what you can expect in 2024 for the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, now sponsored by Grand Gamers Guild.